Now I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. James E. McDowell, who I'll shortly present to you. He is a senior physicist from the University of Arizona and a professor in the Department of Meteorology. He's had research interests in meteorology and many other areas. He's been with the university since 1954. He has a number of professional affiliations, which I won't bother to read with you. He is a member, for example, of the National Academy Science Panel on Weather and Climate Modification, and a member of the American Meteorological Society's Publication Commission, and so on. His credentials are beyond question, and we've asked him to come and talk today to us about a very controversial but a highly interesting aspect of our national and international scene, the question of UFOs. We wanted to have someone come with his type of background that could bring to us the view of a scientist on this very important question. Dr. McDowell.
Thank you, Carl. I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to talk to the AIAA about this topic. I have in the past months been discussing the UFO question with many scientific colleagues in Washington and elsewhere, and there is probably no group to whom the remarks that I've been trying to make are better directed than your own group, because I believe, from what I've seen and learned in the last 15 months, having a full-time study of the UFO problem, that very far from being the nonsense problem that it's rather widely cracked up to be, the UFO problem is instead one of enormous scientific interest. I listened with interest this morning to the various speakers' views on the decade ahead in space planning, and if you didn't note a certain intermixture of pessimism about competing budgetary claims and the Vietnam and so on, I'm afraid I did, as a person rather far removed from space sciences. I sense a certain amount of outright pessimism, but at least reminders to you that the things that are visible by ahead might interfere with rapid growth of the space program at the same time that we're pushing ahead on there. Well, one of the things that I'm going to say to you today, trying to get across very emphatically, is this. I believe that the UFO problem, when it finally gets out in the open, and it is not now out in the open, is likely to, I don't make a flat assertion, is likely to have a very profound and very favorable effect, influence on space sciences planning in the United States and the world as a whole. Likely, but not certain. And I say that because after 15 months of interviewing witnesses, I believe I've talked to about 250 witnesses in key cases in the United States, and recently I was down in Australia and New Zealand, just got back from there some weeks ago. In talking to these witnesses in cases, getting right down to the people who have seen the objects, who have been out in the field or in their car or flying beside the objects, I have slowly eliminated my point of view as a scientist with some awareness of the alternative hypotheses. I've eliminated as likely explanation of the UFO phenomenon really all but the absurd, unreasonable, unlikely, and yet extremely interesting hypothesis that these may be extraterrestrial probes engaged in surveillance. This is not any original idea of my own, of course. Various people have a great deal of knowledge of the UFO problem, but outside the main channels of science have been saying this to us, collectively, for quite a few years, and we haven't collectively, got myself in, been listening to them. A certain amount of arrogance involved there, I believe it's fair to say, and a certain amount of we're all busy, why worry about the nonsense problem, and a very, very large measure, accounting for this lack of attention to the pleas that remain from without the scientific committee, a very large measure of feeling on the part of all of us, down to Congress, press, public at large, that the agency which was charged with the duty of keeping track of this problem was doing a good job. I was not so until I finally got up to write letters and spent, of course, 3 visits up there, a lot of time looking at the files, talking to the people involved, talking to the general in charge of the division, talking to the chief scientist, talking to the chief scientist himself, going to Washington, talking to Air Force civilian scientists, and talking to people at lower operating levels in the Air Force in all parts of the country. I finally came to realize that confidence, which would ordinarily be well put, was ill put. The handling of the UFO problem has been inept, superficial, very incompetent. And I pulled no punches on that. I've said that to Air Force generals. I say it to you as a fellow scientist. There has not been a scientific investigation of the UFO problem. Those of us who thought that all these explanations we've been given probably were the result of careful investigation had better just plain forget about that. I said to at least one Air Force general that when the word gets out fully, the Air Force will look very, very sad. And I'm afraid that is a statement that I would make with stronger underscoring now than when I made it a little more than a year ago to General Cruikshank and Wright Patterson. The general's comment to me was, well, after all, this is a very low priority project. We pay almost no attention to it. And I pointed out to General Cruikshank that he did not have to emphasize that to me because any Air Force project which consists of a major, a sergeant, and a secretary. That's Project Google. That's the Air Force headquarters project. It's a pretty low Air Force. But it's still worse than that. I want to get on quickly from this. I don't particularly, it's not a constructive scientific contribution to make these negative comments, but it's indispensable to convey to you what I have found in looking very closely. If even that one officer who was there had scientific comments, and if his predecessors, there have been about 6 public officers that sent him to you, if any of those had scientific comments, knew a little meteorological optics, knew radar propagation physics, knew aerodynamics, meteoritics, astronomy, there might have been trouble. But in fact, the low priority to which this thing has sunk over the years has made it such that really quite untrained people who don't even know whether explaining the UFOs in terms of twinkling stars that are at Nader rather than being in the open sky, they have been getting Air Force into more and more hot water, which apparently no one in the Air Force really recognizes. It's a long story, and for many more details on this, see the paper that I have asked Bob Riley to put outside the room here. There are about 150 or 200 copies, something like that, of a paper I presented in April to the American Society of Newspaper Editors. It's a good opportunity to lay on the line a lot of the history as I've seen it, my view of the problem, and see that for many more details on the Air Force handling of the problem, and in particular on the CIA involvement in the UFO problem, which is very understood. A few people are aware of this, but it came as quite a surprise to me when I first got to Wright Patterson and asked for a copy and was given a copy of the Robertson Panel Report of January 1953. Mind that date. January 1953 is a turning point in the history, not just of the American investigation of UFOs, but because of the weight that the American Air Force has carried abroad. And I just come from Australia where I saw some good examples of that. The turning point in the whole history of the investigation was there in January 1953. And again, for more detail, see that paper that's in the back of the room. But briefly, the CIA and the air intelligence groups were so concerned with the flood of UFO reports that came through in 1952 in general, and July of 1952 in particular, that they assembled this panel. Robertson of MIT, Caltech, now dead, and 4 or 5 quite good men, Lloyd Berger, also dead recently, members of the panel. They met for a few days, and this is the heart of trouble. They did not dig into the problem at all. They saw no evidence of hostility in the UFOs, no artifacts of a hostile foreign power, that's in the wording. They recommended an educational program to try to get the public straightened out on confusing Venus and various things like this. And it is true that many people do confuse fireballs and so on, think they're something unusual. But these recommendations and findings of the Robertson Committee in 1953 are subordinate in importance to the fourth and still not fully disclosed recommendation, which I, by an error on the part of the major who declassified the document for me right across the desk on the mistaken notion that it came under the DOD 12-year rule, and later it was reclassified when the CIA heard about it. I have seen it, and very few this a long before the CIA reclassified it. I have discussed it with quite a few dozen scientific colleagues. They asked for a debunking policy. And this is the literal, not my, that's not my phraseology. They requested that the Air Force debunk the flying saucers, and the stated reason was to reduce public interest in the flying saucers. And this was because of the sheer bulk of UFO reports that came in that year that were jamming the intelligence channels of the Air Force. And granted that the group of five scientists who took a three-day look at the problem decided there wasn't anything to it in the way of the hostile foreign powers, and accepting their conclusion that there wasn't anything of evidence scientific, they asked for this policy. It was immediately followed by the promulgation of Air Force Regulation 200-2, which made it a $10,000 over 10 years in prison crime for any air base level, and that includes Army base, Marine base, Navy base, operating level personnel, to divulge any information on it unidentified. And there was immediate step function drop in the number of military sightings that got out, and set in motion a whole series of events which, as I read the record, led finally to a degrading UFO problem to where I believe, sincerely, could be wrong, but this is my belief based on a great deal of discussion and analysis, that the Air Force fell victim to its own propaganda, and personnel changed, people came in having heard that the Air Force doesn't believe, and little by little, they lost track more and more of it. And yet, it is unbelievable what you see in the record. If I'm using a number of fairly strong adjectives and adverbs, don't believe that I do this in just every problem I discuss. This problem is one that demands pretty strong adjectives and adverbs. When the full record is out, and you all see it sooner or later, it will be hard to believe that not only our Air Force, the Russian Air Force, the British Air Force, the RAF, the RCAF, and all the rest of them, have all this time failed to recognize that in our airspaces, are operating some kind of craft on which none of our air forces seem to have any knowledge. This will be very hard to believe as you see the record fully as it comes out, and I have been looking at it in great detail, and this I find very hard to understand. But there are many factors that are involved. It's a messy problem. It's not packaged for neat delivery to mathematical physicists who can apply his equations to it. It's a problem in which anecdotal data, to a large extent, is what you have to start out with, and many scientists don't care for that. Well, I'm not very happy about dealing with anecdotal data either, but sometimes you go with what you've got, and this is where we're going to have to tackle the problem to start in order to get the problem upgraded to where agencies with the type of resources, scientific and budgetary, can do justice to the design of entirely new types of sensing systems to get objective rather than subjective anecdotal, objective monitoring of what in the world is going on in the UFO phenomenon. As soon as you're trying to draw any conclusions about the patterns of UFO movements, if you keep your wits about you, you give up. You give up because you're dealing with a category of data, the volume of which is not influenced primarily by the real event, the real stimulus, but by the local credence played and paid by local newspapers and radio and so on. The ridicule lid, which fluctuates from one time to another, and fluctuates geographically because some editor may become a bit concerned after a good sighting in an area, is obviously the most potent factor in varying the number of reports that come out to public attention, whether through Air Force channels or through groups like NICAP in Washington or through just press reporting. The fluctuations in the ridicule are the main factors in changing the number of reports that come out. If any attempt to answer such a pertinent question, and I have given a great deal of thought to this, but I have no answers to give you, but questions such as what geographic patterns are involved? Are there changes in time? Are you doing anything different now from what was going on in 1947? Runs smack up against the difficulty that you just can't dare draw firm conclusions from any of this at present because the subjective psychological factor of ridicule is extremely unfair. Same thing in Australia. I was quite surprised when I was down in Australia, interviewed 80 witnesses in cases in Australia in June and July, and ridicule exerts exactly the same effect in keeping these out of sight in Australia as it does in the U.S. Well, the problem is to replace that kind of data with objective data, and this will only be done when some large science-oriented agency takes a look at the problem. I have talked to the National Science Foundation, to groups in the Office of Naval Research, to
Pentagon people, ARPA, and I have made some attempts to talk to NASA. I have said repeatedly, I say it again today more emphatically than before, that I believe this problem belongs in NASA's hands. It definitely belongs in the science-oriented agency's hands, not in an agency charged with the defense of the United States. There is no cogent indication of hostility in the part of in the evidence that is before us. Hence, it doesn't belong with the Air Force or the Navy or anybody else. And they have exhibited complete inability of coping with the problem scientifically. I believe it belongs with NASA, and much more so because of the high likelihood, again, hypothesis, likelihood, probably, not flat assertions, high likelihood, in my opinion, that strange as it would seem to all of us, as we are in fact, that we are under some kind of surveillance. That brings into the space sciences area. NASA is the organization that is concerned with these problems. NASA is an organization with resources and experience on a large enough scale to cope with the problem. Finally, it is an international problem, and out of the international problem, the reports that I found, I was checking in Australia, are not distinguishably different from those in the United States. The same type of car stopping, cases interference with ignition and lights, same type of car pacing, aircraft pacing cases, the same types of objects down there as here, discs and cigars. Now, I had known that in the form of reports before I went down to Australia, but I don't trust secondhand reports unless I know the person who's giving them to me pretty well. So I picked Australia as a likely area to have a look at for a number of reasons, and it was very productive. And there is a place nearly halfway around the globe from the United States where there's no difference in the UFO phenomena from what's going on in Minnesota, Tucson, Arizona, and the Bangor, Maine, and so on. So I'm now inclined, by extrapolation, to give increased credence to the many reports I've read from South America, probably more reports from South America than any other part of the world. Don't ask me why that's the case, whether it's a real phenomenon, whether it's a psychological phenomenon, or what it is, but there are more reports probably from South America than anywhere else. The largest wave of reports in terms of concentration of time is in France, not the United States, but in France, September and October of 1954. Now, I have talked to some French investigators who are involved in checking these. I am strongly inclined to give full credence. Sometimes I haven't been there and talked to the French peasants, but I've been to Australia. I've talked to the truck drivers and the scientists and so on, and I say that there is no reason to think that the UFO phenomenon, whatever it really is anything but global. That really implies it's an international scientific problem of a quite unprecedented sort, and if it is in fact surveillance, it is the most international problem that has ever come along. An organization like NASA, with experience in this type of area, is immediately better suited than any one of our DOD agencies on that one ground alone. Well, this is one of my main point. I don't have much time today, and the real place to spend time with scientists about the problem, the place to spend your time, you have a lot of strong about cases. But one good case that's carried any conviction is at least worth a half an hour of discussion in itself, and I'm trying to get across some of the general, I'm trying to summarize for you in the limited time I have here, the findings of a 15-month study of the problem, and we'll shortly turn to as much case analysis as I can squeeze into the few minutes left. I emphasize that I think there will be a profound effect on the space sciences. I think that public opinion will be pressing for attention to the UFO problem as an aspect of the space science program in a way that is not to be confused with any other of Mr. Carr has emphasized how much noise the farmers make, and that's true. I came from Farm Belt too, Nicola advised. But wait till the public finds out about the real UFO facts, and you will see pressure for action on this program, which you haven't seen before. So it belongs in a group somewhat like NASA, and not the National Science Foundation. I found great interest when I spoke to NSF, but not any indication of, well, let's get going on this. Quite the opposite. I asked Hayworth's second in command if I could get a few hundred to a few thousand dollars to get down to Australia. Well, sorry, we couldn't do this. It's a loving problem. It's a problem which everybody seems to be waiting around, afraid to touch because it's been discredited for so long. And in any event, it doesn't belong in NSF's hands. It has to be handled by some group that came out and deploy a continental scale, relatively global scale, monitoring system to get started on the assembly of really reliable data on what the dickens is going on. It is really hard to convey in any convincing way in brief. fresh in my hands after these months of studying the problem. How important I think it is, how bewildering it is, the inexplicable phenomena that are involved in the credible UFO reports. But I want to say that in summary. Well, the possible explanations that have been considered to start out usually with a bunch of nuts, and there are a bunch of nuts that are very interested in UFO problems. Well, I give them a shot for it because they cause no problem at all. As soon as you look at Crampton or his writings, you can quite immediately throw that out. The giveaway is quite superficial. But the possibility that there are frauds and fabrications is it has to get more serious. There are frauds and fabrications, and I've looked at quite a few of them. But they're small in number and in percentage case. Most of the time you're dealing with some person says, well, if you don't get the indium too negative in your questioning, you get the kind of reaction, well, hang on, or forget about it, I don't want to talk to you. Dealing with somebody who has seen something, who is very puzzled about it, who reluctantly describes what he saw, and is not at all interested in the publicity. Most of the time, that's the last thing a UFO witness wants, because it's gotten around that people who report these things are branded as nuts. And so you find that it's really pretty uncommon to have dishonest people reporting these, but not unheard of. Then there is the Dover Air Force hypothesis that these are misinterpreted natural phenomena, largely falling in my own field of atmospheric physics. Well, I've taken a very, very careful look at this, and without going into detail, I can assure you most emphatically that the Air Force explanations in terms of low-flying sun dogs and various corona and mirage phenomena, for instance, the sighting that began the whole thing in a public way occurred only about 50 miles from here. June 24th of 1947 was the day that the main flying saucer was coined. The way this thing, the date on which this thing burst out in the open, a private pilot named Ken Arnold saw 9 disc-like objects pass in front of the air and go down to and climb out above Mount Adams. According to his report, I've talked with him at length. I've gone over the radio sound data and examined very carefully. The Air Force claimed that this is a mirage. That's utter balderdash. The radio sound sounding for the day in question involved no discontinuity of temperature that could possibly produce mirage phenomena. Even if you discount everything else in the sighting, that's completely out of question, and there was much more that could be said about that. But there were a lot of atmospheric physical phenomena that have been involved, and they're all wet. Discussions of radar sightings, for instance, the famous one in Washington, D.C. in July 1926, there were 2 successive weekends. Truman got up on his hind heels about this and demanded that the Air Force come forward with some explanation, which they did. The explanation was an almost propagation of radar and a mirage phenomenon. It's a little boring. It's all there is to it. You look at the radio sound data from the Washington airport from Silver Hill, which is just across the river that day, and the refractive index gradient doesn't come anywhere near producing ducting of the type that gives anomalous propagation, and the suggestion that the same temperature and moisture distribution which would give radar refractive anomalies would produce optical frequency phenomena is the sort of thing you get from people who don't know much physics, and they have been operating in the UFO problem in Project Blue Book for many, many years, and these explanations are all, but I don't mean to imply that some of the reports that emerge as UFO reports are not Venus and fireballs, because many are. But immediately, as soon as you start to interrogate the witness, you can sort these cases out. And the kind of cases that are of interest are ones like this one. A pilot with 18,000 hours. His name is Powell. He flies an executive plane now for an Eastern firm, Central Buck Eastern Division. 18,000 hours accumulated in the RCAF, the American Air Force, and then KLM, now flying executive. And he was flying that, this was a year ago, April 21st, 1966, over a suburb of Philadelphia. Flying along at 4,000 feet, 15-mile visibility, 3 in the afternoon, midday, saw an object pull out. There were some jets that came up from a little row of the naval air station under his wing. He suddenly spotted what he thought was an aircraft off the side, closing rapidly with a rear group of jets, and suddenly realized there was no tail fin on the thing. And the next thing he knew, it made a sharp, as near as you could tell, about 160-degree angle turn, no slew, no bank, and came on up for a few close moments, looked to him like a collision course. But it passed his starboard wing at an estimated 100 yards. Now, distance estimates, of course, poor in the air, but 100, 200, what do you like? It was not 10 miles. And he said the same, well, his mild phraseology was kind of a fellow. He said, just like looking at a Cadillac. It was a dome disc with a white dome and a bright red base, no exhaust, no propellers, no wings. I think just coming along at an estimated couple hundred miles an hour past his wing after the Luskin, which he was flying. And I hate to tell you this, but it's an aspect of the problem. It disappeared. And the simple thing for us to do is to smile and laugh. And that's what I did, shook my hand to dismay when I first heard of these cases. I don't understand how an object disappears. I have the slightest idea how an object disappears. In fact, the only case I've ever heard where a pretty good witness said that an object which was in full view in midday condition just disappeared, that was the only case I'd say, well, something is wrong with that. And I did query a problem at some length about whether it could have just undergone a very rapid acceleration off an angle. He said he was sorry, he didn't think that's what happened. I said, let me see, another person flying. Both of them felt it had just disappeared. But the main part is here is a daytime sighting of a solid object, apparently solid object coming by, and suddenly exhibiting itself as a completely unconventional object. Well, there are not tens of such cases, there are hundreds of such cases. I've been working on an instance in a case in Trinidad, Colorado, where I've interviewed now 10 witnesses who saw two and some saw three disc-shaped objects, 5 in the afternoon, a good clear day, at a distance of about half a mile, over the ridge near Trinidad, and then take off. Same thing in Australia. Midday sightings, a case of an Anglican clergyman whom I interviewed in Tasmania, who was standing in the rectory window of all places to get halfway believable. Robert Browning and his wife suddenly saw coming out from behind a rain curtain a large dirigible-shaped object, metallic-looking, an estimated 3 miles away. From there, the estimate is not too good, probably about a factor of 2. They thought it was about 300 feet long. It was coming out at some slow speed that they thought it was in stall. They saw 50 or 60 miles an hour. They thought it was an airplane crashing, and suddenly just stopped in midair. Then from the rain shower off to the distance farther east from them came a total of 5 or 6 small dome discs that they put about 30 or 40 feet. These things maneuvered around, the object took formation in a certain position, and after a total viewing time of about a minute, the entire entourage went back into the rain shield and disappeared. Again, a full daytime sighting, and there are indeed very, very large numbers of these. There are sightings by scientists. It's often said that why don't scientists see these things? Well, there are scientists have seen.
At this point, the tape ran out, and before another tape could be started, Dr. McDonald had finished. His concluding point was that Project Blue Book should be turned over to the NASA administration. Please return this tape to me, Monty Montgomery, Boeing Plant 2 Theater, so that others may hear it.